Welcome back to Versus the Network, everybody. This is the show where we take a look at shows that were screwed over by the network and tell you, the viewer, how you can learn from these mistakes. We're back for a second round, and oh boy, is it gonna be even crazier than the last. Except for maybe the Weird Al one. That's probably still gonna be the worst, but we got one that's pretty close coming up towards the end, so just wait until that happens. Anyways, on to round two. Do any of you know what the channel UPN was? Or is, because I guess they brought it back? But it was the United Paramount Network, and it was known as one of the worst networks around at the time because they could just never get anything right. Not only were people not watching the channel, but they also struggled to get any good shows at all. Now look, I know UPN had some great shows and all, but I'm just saying that for every good show they had about three or four that sucked, okay? We clear on that? Good, you can stop typing now, okay? People always considered UPN a giant joke from when it started all the way till when it finished in 2006. Sounds like the perfect place to put the Dilbert animated series, right? For those who are unaware, Dilbert is one of the most successful comic strips of all time. While it's not up there with the likes of, say, Peanuts or Garfield in terms of revenue, you take a look at the cast and you can immediately tell, yeah, that's Dilbert, yeah, that's Wally, yeah, that's Catbird, and so on. For years, it had been gaining an audience through worker bees or just the general public who loves to see the office antics. And eventually, they ended up making a TV show that went on UPN. Oh, this can only go terribly. So let's get started with Versus the Network 201, what to do when the network constantly keeps dropping the ball. First off, despite airing on UPN, the show was actually really freaking good, to the point where I'd say that it's probably the best comic strip adaptation of all time. Yes, better than Garfield and Friends. Now, I love Garfield and Friends, it's great. However, unlike that, it didn't have to rework its style to fit the longer format. Instead, this is 100% Dilbert through and through, uncompromised in basically every way. This feels like a 22-minute comic strip come to life, albeit with a more beginning, middle, and end 3-act structure. The casting in the show is perfect as well. It's to the point where now when I read Dilbert, I always imagine their voices to sound like how they do in the show. Because this is just amazing. Kathy Griffin as Alice, Daniel Stern as Dilbert, and so on. These people do an amazing job. Now, how did UPN screw it all up? Because let's face it, we know that they did. Well, it started off alright at first. The first episode got a lot of viewership, whether it's because of the media blitz that happened before it, or the fact that it's Dilbert, so of course people are gonna watch it. It was a huge success. During the first season, they even got nominated for a Primetime Emmy Award. It was that good. So, before Dilbert came on, there was another show called Shasta McNasty, and it is one of the worst shows of all time. And that's not just me saying it. Dilbert creator Scott Adams says the same thing. This show is basically just a brain-dead show, plain and simple. It's about three idiots being idiots, and that's about it. It's crude, it's crass, and it's poorly written, not to mention that it's extremely loud. Scott Adams said that the only people that would find Shasta McNasty funny would be the kind of people who would die in a bowling ball cleaning accident. Oh boy. Shasta McNasty was in the time slot right before Dilbert, and I know what you're thinking. Oh yeah, Shasta McNasty sucks and Dilbert's great, so obviously, people wouldn't want to watch Shasta and they'd watch Dilbert instead, right? Wrong! This actually hurt Dilbert tremendously because 75% of the audience back then would want to watch the show after another, so yeah, you don't want to watch Shasta McNasty, so you're going to skip Dilbert instead, especially if they're part of the same hour. This is one of the reasons why Alan Gregory was placed in between The Simpsons and Family Guy, because the Fox network thought that Alan Gregory was so bad that people would only want to watch it if The Simpsons and Family Guy were on right alongside it. Of course, it didn't work. But still, that was the reasoning. So Shasta McNasty was the first nail in the coffin for Dilbert, but it wasn't the last. Shasta McNasty was a storm cloud that lingered over their head throughout their entire run on the UPN, and it only got worse. So with their ratings declining because of Shasta McNasty's increasingly worse reputation, UPN got a little desperate. They did the same thing that every network does when they hit the panic button. They get a bunch of celebrity guest stars, and don't get me wrong, it was great to have them here, but why were they needed? did CompuComp really needed to be voiced by Jerry Seinfeld, or did we really need Stone Cold Steve Austin? No, not really. But again, they did a good job and they were enjoyable to see. It just felt kinda odd that about two-thirds of the second season decided to shoehorn guest stars in for basically no reason at all. And of course, just like CBS did with the Weird Al show and its mountain of guest stars, UPN didn't really do anything about it, so they didn't say, hey, Stone Cold Steve Austin's here, hey, Jerry Seinfeld's here. They didn't do any of that. No, it was up to the viewer to determine, oh yeah, using my psychic link to UPN, I can determine that Wayne Knight's gonna be in this episode. I can't wait to see it! Once again, the whole point of having celebrity guest stars is to boost ratings. But how can that work if nobody knows they're gonna be on the show? It's like the network wants them to fail. With Dilbert, it's hard to say. There's an ongoing argument amongst people who even know what UPN is, trying to decide whether they were evil or just stupid, and honestly, I'm not sure where I lie, so I'll probably ask you that at the end of the video. And it got worse for Dilbert because in between seasons 1 and 2, there was an executive shakeup, and that only ever leads to good things. This executive shakeup caused Dilbert to change time slots again, and again, and again, often with little notice. So picture this. You're coming home from work one day and you decide to catch a new episode of your favorite show, Dilbert. You've been trying to avoid Shasta McNasty this whole time because it's so terrible and it's been poisoning your show. So, who cares about that? You can just ignore it, have a nice day, and turn on the TV and oh no! It's another Shasta McNasty! They're procreating! But no, it wasn't another showing of Shasta McNasty. It was just the time slot being bumped up by a half hour. Without you ever knowing. And this happened multiple times. This is what killed stuff like Dave the Barbarian, guys. Whenever you have a successful show and you really have to change the time slot, let people know. Otherwise, it's gonna fail. And Dilbert ended up failing because of this. Season 2 got atrocious viewership, and of course, given the fact that UPN already didn't have the best numbers anyways, it was time for Dilbert to come to a close. But that wasn't the only reason they decided to cancel Dilbert. The other reason was racism. Not on the part of Scott Adams, but on the part of UPN. UPN decided that they wanted to be a discount BET, having programming that would cater more towards the African-American demographic, so they, in Scott Adams' words, fired him because he was too white. Yeah, that's great. Like, I know diversity and equal opportunity stuff is good and all, but when it's at the expense of another demographic or group of people, I don't know, that just doesn't seem right. And before you start typing an angry comment calling me a racist or whatever, keep in mind, UPN had been trying to do diversity and equal opportunity programming for a while, but ended up making things like Homeboys in Outer Space, thinking that the African-American demographic would think that that was relatable. Yeah, they don't have a very good track record at all. They're the kind of people that think that all African-Americans have, like, saggy pants and gold teeth and all that sort of stuff. So in this case, whether you are black or you're white, you're not gonna win! Everyone loses here, because everyone's a loser with UPN. No wonder this thing went under and nobody cared about it. Since then, there have been a lot of talks about bringing Dilbert back or making a Dilbert movie, but they never came to fruition. It seems like Scott Adams doesn't want to go through it all again, and to be honest, I don't really blame him. After the experience he had with UPN, where they constantly stuck a knife in his back again and again, seemingly unable to get anything right, that'd scare me from adapting my thing too. I wouldn't want that at all. Nobody would. It's not that the network didn't give him enough support, it's just that they seem to go out of their way to get everything wrong. And the hardest part about this is that it was a really good show, and if it was on another network, it probably would have done really well. Rowdy C from TV Trash said that if it was on, say, Adult Swim, they probably wouldn't have given it the time or attention it deserved. But for one thing, it couldn't have been worse than what UPN did, and secondly, I think they would have. Because don't forget, this is around the time when they had a lot of really big hit shows like Aqua Teen Hunger Force or reruns of Family Guy. They were looking to build up that big lineup that they always wanted, and having a high-profile name like Dilbert in a show that had really good quality would have been exactly what they were looking for. And since they had the same censoring practices as UPN, which is basically none, Dilbert probably would have been the same if it was on Adult Swim instead. To this day, I've been unable to figure out why Scott Adams wanted Dilbert on UPN. Maybe that was the only offer he had. Maybe they just gave him a lot of money or a lot of leeway. But still, with Shasta McNasty, time slot changes, forcing in celebrity guest stars, and of course, racism, you can definitely see here what happens when the network keeps dropping the ball. So how can you, the potential show creator, benefit from this? Well, you can never benefit from an unsupportive network, so all you can really do is do your research. What do other people in the industry think of them? Have you heard any horror stories coming from them? What do you think that you both can get out of this partnership? Because it's not just you working for them, this is a partnership. Both sides have to benefit, and if it's a little lopsided, then something's probably gonna go horribly wrong for one party. Maybe even both. With the internet and social media, it's very easy to tell what these stories and benefits will be. However, back then, it was a lot harder. So, in a weird, messed up way, it's almost a good thing that we have things like Dilbert out there that have gone horribly wrong, because now future creators can take a look at it and then know how to fend for themselves in this dog-eat-dog industry. I can't believe it! After all these years, VeggieTales is finally gonna be on national TV!
Allura! It is so very exciting!
So when are we gonna film the pilot? Come on, I've got ants in my pants! You mean that metaphorically, don't you? Let's just say that these pants are dry clean only, and I don't have enough money to get them cleaned. Oh, well, good for you.
Big Ideas never had this kind of opportunity before. So I know that we can't blow it when we finally—
Just a moment! Wait! Stop talking! Excuse me, but I have an announcement. Ahem. Because of the high standards that NBC tries to adhere to, and as a result of the disastrous screening of one of your previous episodes, management has decided to adhere to a more secular tone for your series. Many styles were screened, and we chose one based around overall marketability and overall silliness. Thank you. So, what are you saying? I'm saying that NBC won't let us talk about God on our show.
They
what? That's the whole point of the show! Yes, I said the same thing, but they just wouldn't listen. Well then, what's the point of going on? If the first ever Christian children's show featuring an all-vegetable cast is not allowed to talk about Christian things, then it feels like we're wasting our time. Why even bother? You know, this could influence our DVD sales. Well, it's what the network wants. Why bother to complain? God remains a ghost, some things we can't control.
I got a bad feeling about this.
You and me both.
I have a long history with VeggieTales, and if you've been with my content for a long, long time, I'm sure you know that full well. If not, well then I'm not really gonna explain it here. There are so many other videos on this channel that would do a much better job. Honestly, it'd just be a bit redundant to go through the whole thing again, so I won't. Ha. But today, we're gonna talk about the show once again, but this time in a very different way. We're not gonna be talking about the mainline direct-to-video series, nor the revival series, or that Netflix series that came in between. This time, we're gonna talk about VeggieTales' seldom talked about and short-lived Kubo series. For those who don't know, Kubo was NBC's Saturday morning cartoon block, and they had a bunch of shows like, yeah, I didn't really watch Kubo very much, in case you can't tell. But yes, they decided to take VeggieTales, the most popular Christian children's show of all time next to Adventures in Odyssey, and take the content from the DVDs onto TV. Sort of. The transfer did not go very well. It was a very rocky process with mixed results. So now, let's get into Versus the Network number 202. What happens when you and the network just aren't a good fit? We're gonna have to go way back on this one, like way, way back to the early 1990s. Phil Vischer and Mike Naraki had an idea to make a Christian children's show starring vegetables. What a concept, right? They tried pitching their show to different networks like Nickelodeon, but that wasn't really a good fit because CG technology wasn't really there. At least not enough to make a full-on animated series. After these pitches fell through, they decided to make the show themselves. This involved making the production of the entire first episode in Phil's basement, as well as pulling several brutal all-nighters. When trying to get their episode distributed, they were turned down by places like Walmart because it had Christian values. Having their product there would apparently alienate a lot of their target demographics, so VeggieTales was outright rejected. It's possible that they would have been let in if they cut the stuff out, but that's not what VeggieTales was meant for, not at all. So Phil and Mike stood their ground and decided to release the episodes via mail order, and then little by little their company, Big Idea Productions, began to grow. And grow, and grow, and then Jonah came out and nearly destroyed everything, and then grow, and grow, and grow, and eventually Kubo caught wind of their show and decided that they wanted to air VeggieTales on their network. But there was one little catch. There was this thing in VeggieTales that they didn't like. They didn't want God to be in any of the episodes that they aired, which was kind of a problem at this point. See, when Phil Vischer and Mike Naraki were pitching VeggieTales to Nickelodeon, none of the episodes had been made. Maybe a couple had been written and there were some concepts thrown around, but nothing was outright finished, not even close. But by the time Kubo got their sweaty little hands on VeggieTales, not so much. But now that Phil Vischer was no longer the head of the production company, Big Idea Productions, they decided to go ahead and accept the deal, even though this was going to create a lot of problems. So first off, something I didn't mention is that Kubo didn't exist at the time that VeggieTales ended up making this deal. They were just starting to exist. VeggieTales was actually the first show to ever air on Kubo. Even so, they were still dealing with a big company, NBC, which is, it's kind of a mega corporation, so you don't want to push their buttons. Which means that in order for VeggieTales to be on TV, they would have to do whatever the network said, which meant that they had to splice out every little mention of God that they possibly could and throw it aside. So VeggieTales did end up becoming a morality show in the end, even if it's not the original show, but still, the point stands. This is exactly what Phil Vischer and Mike Naraki were trying to avoid. One of their key points was to keep God in the show as much as possible. Phil Vischer goes on about this at length in his autobiography, Me, Myself, and Bob, which, by the way, even if you're not a Christian or not a VeggieTales fan, I highly recommend you read it. It's a great story of a self-made man that had it all and then lost it all through his sheer inexperience and overexcitement. Honestly, I think it's a great book, regardless of your religious beliefs. But anyways, that wasn't the only thing that they had to change for NBC/Kubo. The episodes were also too long. The earlier ones were okay, like God Wants Me to Forgive Them and Are You My Neighbor, they were at decent lengths. The short running time meant that they were mostly fine. Once they cut out all the God stuff, they were basically good. But then when you get to the later episodes, like Lyle the Kindly Viking or Esther the Girl Who Became Queen, not so much. They were quite long, so a lot of them had to get cut. This involved some very bad editing on the part of whoever put these together. There are just shots that get cut together with no transition or context or anything, and it's kind of jarring. If you haven't seen the original episodes, you might not really know what's going on sometimes. Occasionally, they'll be okay, but in episodes like Larry Boy and the Rumor Weed, it gets really bad. They also cut out the countertop segments as well, partially because of the Bible verse thing and also the fact that, well, they talk about God the most there, at least in terms of percentage-wise when it comes to the runtime of the overall segments. Instead, we got Bob and Larry at Bob's house talking about whatever story they're gonna tell today. Jimmy comes by as their mailman singing a very strange song. He gives them a letter that has this very generic, very happy-go-lucky, wholesome problem, but then one of the VeggieTales characters that are not Bob, Larry, or Jimmy come in and try to fix the problem themselves. Only thing is, they stink at it. Which means it's up to Bob and Larry to tell their story of the week and then solve this kid's pretty inconsequential problem. I mean, let's be real. You don't want to share a cupcake with your sister. I will say, though, that these are still pretty funny and they keep true to the original spirit of the show. But again, we know why they're here. In fact, in some of the earlier episodes, you can very clearly see that Bob's mouth movements say, God made you special and he loves you very much. You know, the main catchphrase and tagline of the show? But I guess they didn't get the memo that they can't say that, even though they had to cut out all the God stuff anyways. So instead, they just dub him over by saying,
Hey kids, thanks for coming to my house today. See you next week!
So, was VeggieTales on Kubo a bad show? Well, no, of course not. It's still VeggieTales. It's still the show that all the little children who grew up in Christian households came to know and love. But the problem is, regardless as to who was in charge of this decision, they really let the integrity of the show go. The entire point was to make sure that kids in a Christian household learned about God and his values. But now that it was on Kubo, yeah, it was reaching more people, but it wasn't the same. It didn't have the same mission statement anymore, and honestly, speaking as someone here in the year 2022, we should have seen this coming as a very big warning sign that whoever was in charge of VeggieTales at this time was more than willing to let the Christian stuff fall to the wayside. As the show went on, we would see more and more episodes getting secularized. In other words, they'd be just basic morality tales that would end up teaching the same lessons that Kubo did, with barely any connection to what made the show work in the first place, at least on a lesson level. And then later on after that, it got even worse with this. At this point, the show became 90% secular. Once again, it decided to go against its original purpose to reach a wide audience. And do you really think that was a good idea? Well, of course, for NBC, yeah, it was a great idea. It made lots of money. But for Big Idea? No, this was a complete betrayal for everything they stood for. Think about it. Do you think that the Phil Vischer and Mike Naraki, back when they were making the first episode, Where's God When I'm Scared, would be proud of the decision that was made to put VeggieTales on TV? Would they really be satisfied with cutting out every single mention of God that was possible in order to reach a wider audience? Chances are, they wouldn't be. I know I wouldn't be. So it's kinda hard to find who's at fault here, because Big Idea knew what they were doing and walked right into it, but at this point, they weren't really the same company, at least not exactly, because they had a bunch of parent organizations telling them what to do. The people at Big Idea themselves still cared, but their overlords not so much. NBC can't be fully blamed either, because they're NBC. They were just trying to look out for the bottom line. You know, that sweet, sweet profit. No, I'm not talking about Jonah, I'm talking about this profit. Cash money. Given the fact that NBC is a giant multinational corporation, obviously, money is their top priority. If kids happen to learn something out of it, great, but they want money above all else. And VeggieTales was a growing brand, and they wanted a part of it. They just didn't end up being a good match. So how can you, the aspiring creator, learn from this? Honestly, just make sure you know who you're pitching to. Kinda like what we learned last week with Dilbert. Dilbert ended up going to UPN, which turned out to be a very bad idea because UPN didn't know what it was doing. It put Dilbert next to one of the worst shows ever, fired everybody on the show because they were racist, and their promotion for the show was kinda screwy. So this is yet another example of make sure you know who you're doing business with. Do you really think that your show would be right on this network, or streaming service, or whatever it is? There's that old story of Adventure Time being pitched to Nickelodeon and then they turned it down, only for them to go to Cartoon Network and become a gigantic phenomenon. I see that as a good thing because Adventure Time wouldn't have become the show that everybody fell in love with if they went to Nickelodeon, because Nickelodeon is very, very different from Cartoon Network. They have different goals, different standards and practices, different owners. You may look at some TV networks and think that because they have similar programming, they're automatically the same. But it's not true. They're not just skins that are slapped on with different kinds of programming. No, no, no. They really are different entities, so if you're gonna sell your intellectual property, make sure it's going to the right one, or else, just like VeggieTales, your vision's gonna be compromised, and irreparably so.
So, how was it?
Let's not talk about it till we get the checks. In some ways, I can't help but feel that this was a gigantic mistake.
I agree with, what's your name again? I agree with,
This kind of feels like a betrayal to our overall goal.
Yeah, we know. We just watched a 10-minute video that explained all that.
What do you mean?
The review? The one that came in between all this time that we've had on camera?
Review? What review? Nobody told me that this was a review! Ah, man, and look at me! I didn't even put on my best tie!
I didn't know you wore a tie.
I don't, but I found one on the street the other day, and I didn't want it to go to waste!
Well, at least we can all find some comfort in the fact that this is the lowest that Big Idea is ever gonna sink! Right, guys? Guys? Guys?
So, I've made it pretty clear in the past that I don't really like Family Guy. However, I will say that since I last made that statement, my opinion on it has gotten better. I decided to give it another shot because a lot of people kept begging me to give it one more chance. And no, I still don't like it, but now we're on speaking terms at least, so I guess there's that. It's better than me hating it. I mean, I still don't like it, and I don't think I ever will. Personally, I'm just fine with that. But it's no longer my least favorite show ever. Instead, it's probably in the running for my number one most overrated show ever. But that's a topic for another day. Instead, we got Versus the Network. Ever since we first came up with the idea of Versus the Network, we've wanted to do this. Originally, it was going to be SpongeBob, but then we realized Family Guy is actually a much more unique case than SpongeBob. And you want to know why? Well, stick right here, because we're going to get into Versus the Network number 203, what happens when the network is too supportive of you. First off, before we can analyze what exactly happened here and how you can learn from it, we need to go over Family Guy's origin story, but we need to go over it very quickly because a lot of people have already told this tale. Seth MacFarlane originally had this cartoon called Life with Larry about this old man named Larry and his talking dog named Steve, who, by the way, ended up becoming Peter and Brian respectively. Seth MacFarlane tried to make this into a full-time show, pitching it around from network to network to network, or sometimes to other shows. He wanted to have a kind of Tracy Ullman Simpsons relationship, and his first choice? The Weird Al Show! Yeah, we discussed that on the last Versus the Network. Al decided to turn the show down, which, honestly, I think was actually a good choice on everybody's part, because for Weird Al, Family Guy, or at the time, Life with Larry, didn't really fit. And for Seth MacFarlane, if Life with Larry got sold to CBS, it never would have become Family Guy, and we never would have had any of this. Okay, for me, the second one doesn't really have a lot of weight, but still. He retooled it into Larry and Steve to be a little bit more kid-friendly, and he aired it on the What a Cartoon Show on Cartoon Network. And eventually, through some sheer network magic, he ended up creating Family Guy, which got sold to Fox. And right away, it was a gigantic hit, particularly Stewie and Brian. They were automatically the breakout characters right from the beginning, but still, everyone loved everybody else. It was dark, it was offbeat, it had a lot of cutaway jokes that you didn't see a lot of at the time, but even so, it had grounds, it had boundaries, which would go away in the future, but I'm getting ahead of myself. Family Guy's easy tour of duty ended after season 1. Right from season 2, it got bad. I'm not saying that's when the show got bad or anything, I'm saying that that's when the show struggled to stay alive. Fox decided to reschedule the time slots and put Family Guy up against this little-known NBC show, Frasier. Yeah, not a good idea. Frasier just so happened to be one of NBC's biggest hits at the time, right up there with their other mega hit, Friends. And sure, Family Guy was popular, but it was nowhere near a mainstream success yet. It had a lot of ways to go before it could beat something like Frasier. And sure enough, it didn't, because the network decided to cancel the show, only to go back on their decision to give them a shorter third season, which was supposed to be the end. But Family Guy fans were not happy. They decided to send Adult Swim's reruns of the show through the roof in ratings and buy every bit of merchandise they possibly could. This made them realize that Family Guy still has an audience and maybe, just maybe, canceling the show way too early was a bad idea. Now that alone is already a Versus the Network story in and of itself, but now we get to the real meat. The stuff where things get really, really bad. It seems like Fox was so sorry for cutting Family Guy short that they let the crew do whatever they wanted, and you'd better believe they took advantage of that. Any kind of taboo topic, any unfunny joke that goes on way too long, any sacred cow, whatever it takes. They were gonna do whatever they wanted, when they wanted, hopefully to offend as many people as possible. Now, I as a non-Family Guy fan do have to admit that the early stuff is a lot better. Sometimes it'll actually get me to laugh, I will admit that. So to see it give all that up, just to be yet another Tipping the Rift or Drawn Together Season 3 is really saddening and also kinda concerning, but it didn't stop there. As I'm sure we all know from all those angry mid-2010 reviews out there, the show just kept getting worse and worse and worse. They'd have episodes about herpes, or the dog getting a baby pregnant, or abusive relationships are bad except when there's a lightning rod, then they're good, to abusive relationships are bad, let's just play it like a Hallmark movie. So many bad episodes here, and the bad episodes kept growing. A lot of Family Guy fans were growing concerned because the episodes they knew and loved were becoming fewer and fewer. Simply put, it's because everybody's running out of ideas. It's not like South Park where their whole existence is just a comment on everything that's topical the same week that it becomes popular. Family Guy takes a long time to make. That and it has different purposes from South Park, so it can't really be compared. Its purpose now is just to shock and offend. And I'm not gonna blame it on Seth MacFarlane like a lot of people do, because he actually hasn't written anything for Family Guy in a very long time. There have been a lot of different showrunners and people helping him out, so even if he does deserve the blame, it's not all of it. It's a team of people making this, it's a team of people approving it, but I bet you're wondering, how is this the network's fault? Let me tell you. Over the course of Versus the Network, especially with stuff like the Weird Al show or, hey, last week with Dilbert, we've seen a lot of the time the network will just go after you, they'll make you miserable, they'll cut you short, they'll do whatever they can to screw you over, basically for funsies. But sometimes, it goes the other way. Sometimes they're a little too supportive and they don't want to let you go no matter what. So what that the ratings are going down? So what that critics don't like any of the new episodes? So what that the fans are abandoning the show in droves? We gotta keep going. Family Guy's such an established brand that if we get rid of it, who knows what's gonna become of our multi-billion dollar corporation? In all seriousness though, there's this rumor going around that the crew of Family Guy desperately want the show to end. Some people believe that the reason they keep making these really disgusting and disturbing episodes, at least according to the mainstream audience, I just kind of find them boring because they're just trying way too hard. The reason for those is because they want to get out of doing the show and try other things. Therefore, if they do something so offensive and so provocative that the network decides to pull the plug, they'll finally be free. I'm not really sure I buy it, but if it turns out to be true, I wouldn't really be all that surprised. It's clear that a lot of people on board just want to be done. Similarly, look at The Simpsons. All they really do is basically tread water whenever they make a new episode. They don't do anything new, they don't do anything distinguishing, they just sit there, do nothing, go nowhere, and then it's over. Or how's about Modern Family, where it was good, then it got really bad, then it got meh, then it got good again, and then it got bad, because the network just kept dragging it on way too long. Or of course, SpongeBob or The Loud House. Now, I have a lot more experience with SpongeBob because I grew up with it, and The Loud House, I stopped watching that pretty quickly. But according to a lot of people, it too has lived long past its shelf life. So what does this mean exactly? Well, when you sign over your show to a network, it's theirs. It's no longer yours. Do you really think that Matt Groening still owns The Simpsons? No, he hasn't been on that for a long, long time. It's Fox's property, and they're gonna do whatever they want with it. Whether it becomes unprofitable, or whether it becomes reviled, they're just gonna keep it around because it's force of habit. There's no way. No way that Modern Family Guy is doing gangbusters like it was doing back in, say, seasons 5, 6, or 7. I don't believe it for a second. And look at all these reviews out there about Family Guy. Sure, I made reference to things like Mr. Enter or somebody making a bunch of Family Guy reviews that were very, very negative in the mid-2010s, but even look now, there's just more and more bad press piling up. A lot of people don't want to watch Family Guy anymore. A lot of people are done. It's that old saying, you either go out a hero or you live long enough to see yourself become the villain. Family Guy is the villain of the animation industry. I hate to keep bringing up South Park, but once again, when South Park decided to make fun of Family Guy with Cartoon Wars, not only were they pleased with themselves, but the creators of The Simpsons sent them flowers, and the creators of King of the Hill called them up to say they were doing God's work. Many in the industry hate Family Guy because they say all it is just a bunch of cutaways, mean-spirited characters, characters that break character at the drop of a hat, bad stories, bad structure, bad everything, and yeah, that's kind of my issue with it too. But the show wasn't always this way. Once again, go back to the earlier seasons, 1, 2, 3, and some of 4. Whether or not you like it, you can definitely acknowledge that it has an identity worth having. It's unique. It's different. It stands out from all the other copycat shows out there. Even if it does have a couple tropes like the dumb fat dad or the nagging mom, it strays from the norm just enough to pique your interest. And whether you resonate with the style or not, it's completely up to you. Just like a lot of shows out there that take chances. It's all gone now. They have no way of bringing it back either, because whenever they may have an idea, they'll realize, wait, we already did that. Crap, we're stuck. And the reason I decided to bring up Family Guy instead of the more popular Fairly Odd Parents or SpongeBob SquarePants are for two reasons. One, it's an adult cartoon, and that doesn't happen to a lot of those out there. The only other one I can think of is The Simpsons. South Park only got bad for 2 seasons, and they pulled themselves right out of it, and now they're doing these post-pandemic movies, and I gotta say, best it's ever been. But also because of just how big of a fall it took. SpongeBob had a lot of spiky quality. They had some good episodes here, some bad episodes there. The good ones were pretty decently good, but the bad ones ranged from decently bad to really, really bad. Then there's The Simpsons, which is just mediocre incarnate. But Family Guy just changed its identity, and it's nobody's fault but the network. If they just let it stop, if they let it take a breather even for a couple years, to let the writing staff get their footing back, or maybe hire some people with new ideas, but they can't do that. Family Guy is a brand first and a show second. It's on there because it's a big name. Advertisers keep flocking to the show because people will keep tuning into the reruns and not necessarily liking what they're doing in their new episodes, but still, they gotta keep going with Family Guy. So Fox will keep it around because it keeps making money and people keep coming back to watch it, even though they know it sucks. Listen, I get it. You wanna be loyal to your show. You want to stick by them during the rough parts. I feel that, 100%. But at some point, you just have to acknowledge the show's dead. It's been dead for a long, long time. And sad to say, it's gonna stay dead for the far foreseeable future. All the original staff that made it work have moved on to other things, and the people who are running it now just don't know what to do. But what can you, the aspiring creator, do to prevent this from happening to your show? Sadly, you can't do anything. With this case, you will never see it coming. People never expected SpongeBob to be as big of a hit as it was. People never expected The Simpsons to be as big of a hit as it was. Heck, people didn't expect Family Guy to be as big of a hit as it was. But that's showbiz for you. It just kinda happens. A lot of the projects that networks think are gonna be a big hit end up failing, and the ones that they think are gonna fail end up becoming multinational phenomenons. And again, once you sell your show to a network, that's it. It's out of your control. You're the creator, yeah, but you're also, at this point, staff. If they don't like the direction you're taking the show, they can let you go. But it's important to make sure that while you're on the show, it stays as good as it could possibly be. While you're working there, keep your integrity. Keep your dedication. Keep your drive. Because otherwise, the downfall will happen under your watch, and believe me, you do not want that. So yes, this may have been a little bit more of a dark versus the network in the fact that you can't really do anything to stop it, but at least you know that it's possible. So if you are gonna pitch a show, if you are gonna be a creative mind out there, be warned, your show just might end up being the next Family Guy. We're going back to the very first thing that was ever covered on Media Mementos, the failed WB animated sitcom adaptation of the comic strip Baby Blues by Rick Kirkman and Jerry Scott. As stated in that video, this is one of the worst adaptations ever, but it still managed to work on its own. However, similar to Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, it doesn't differentiate itself enough to be its own thing. So yeah, it's kinda complicated how to interpret this thing, but we're not here to discuss that, are we? We're here to discuss what happened behind the scenes, and let me tell you, it's a wild, wild ride. So get ready for Versus the Network number 205, what happens when the network doesn't want you for you. So it goes without saying that Baby Blues was a giant success. Much like Peanuts or Calvin and Hobbes, it embraced wholesome, family-friendly humor. For those who are unfamiliar with the strip, let me explain it to you. Baby Blues is about Daryl and Wanda McPherson and their struggles in raising their 1, 2, and later 3 kids. The humor mostly revolves around family hijinks or kids say the darndest things, and while it's not everybody's cup of tea, I definitely like to read it every so often just for a little bit of a wholesome laugh. It's really easily accessible and hey, it's inoffensive, so what's wrong with it, right? And a lot of readers seem to think the same thing because it caught on like wildfire, and it kept growing and growing and growing, much like the family in the strip itself. A strip with this kind of growth and following would obviously catch the attention of some greedy television executives, and that's certainly what happened here. The WB network, which now no longer exists and kinda lives on as the CW, but not really, got in contact with Kirkman and Scott to make an adaptation of Baby Blues for prime time. The duo liked the idea and signed on, and right away the problems began. Kirkman and Scott had little to no involvement in the production of the Baby Blues show whatsoever. In fact, as you'll find out later, they were out of touch with so much going on that they actually had to fight to get one of the most drastic changes undone. This wasn't their fault, of course. They really wanted to be involved with the production of the show. It's just that WB didn't really feel the same way. They had their own vision for what Baby Blues should and could be, and they were not part of it. So what was this vision exactly? Let me put it this way. Around this time, WB mostly catered to people that were in the late teens to early adults category, so they wanted a show that fit that demographic. And right away you can tell that this is not a good fit. Baby Blues is meant for all ages, not necessarily an older teen demographic like Buffy the Vampire Slayer, so what's going on here? Are they gonna kinda make it more adult or something? Yes and no. Well, yes, they were most certainly gonna make it adult, kind of fitting in with shows like The Simpsons and Family Guy, which apparently were their main inspirations for the show in the first place, but they were also gonna make some drastic changes to the story overall. First of all, Daryl and Wanda were gonna go back to having just one kid, Zoe. My guess is that they were gonna add the other kids later on, kind of like what they do in the strip, where every so often they'll get just a little bit older and a little bit older, and then bam, another kid comes along. Whoops. I'm not really sure if they intended it to be this way, but knowing their aims for the show, I wouldn't be surprised. But having Zoe kind of takes away from the family element in Baby Blues altogether. Babies can't talk. Babies don't really have personalities when they're in TV shows unless they're fantastical creatures like Poof. This means that the WB would be able to put a lot more focus on the other characters aside from the McPherson family, because yes, that's one of the other changes they made to Baby Blues, giving them their own supporting cast, which, on one hand, I totally understand. The show wouldn't work if it was just Daryl, Wanda, and Zoe. You need some neighbors, you need some friends, but what they put in the show? That was not a good choice at all. We got Busy, Zoe's babysitter, who's basically your stereotypical bratty teenage girl. We got Kenny, who's Daryl's lecherous co-worker. And of course, we have the real main characters of Baby Blues, the Bittermans. Daryl and Wanda's crazy, off-the-chain neighbors. It's through these characters that we would get the most infamous changes in the show. The bad language, the adult humor, the pop culture references, and so on. You know, all those things that the original comic strips stood against? The WB wasn't really concerned with making Baby Blues at all. They just wanted to make another version of The Simpsons or Family Guy, something adult, something marketable. The reason that they decided to make Baby Blues their adaptation of choice was because of one thing and one thing only, the name. They knew that Baby Blues was popular, they knew that it had a lot of merchandise and collection books, so they wanted to get that audience to come to the WB and maybe sacrifice their expectations for what this adaptation should be on the small screen. Little did they know that this was gonna backfire tremendously. People came to Baby Blues for a specific thing, and this show didn't provide it. In fact, it barely provided Daryl and Wanda at all. For one thing, the writers were so focused on these new characters that every single episode, I repeat, every single episode is more about either Busy or the Bittermans than Daryl and Wanda. They're always involved in the conflict. They're always involved in the resolution. We can't have a single episode where one or both of these groups are not pivotal players. And while Daryl and Wanda get more of the screen time, and I guess you could call it character development, it's pretty shallow, but I guess it's there. They don't get a lot of the funniest jokes. They don't get some of the more memorable sequences. They wanted to make their own characters shine, and then these other ones that were kinda there basically to trap the viewers, yeah, they're just along for the ride, who cares about them? But there were some warning signs popping up right away. WB Animation was going through a lot of budget constraints at the time. I'm not sure of the exact reason why, but according to this article from Animation World Network, it was because a lot of the WB animated shows were starting to fall apart. Hysteria was getting too expensive and ended up getting canceled, and then of course there was Pinky Elmira in the Brain, which was a total disaster. That, and without the popularity of shows like Animaniacs and Pinky in the Brain anchoring their network, they were hemorrhaging money. Which means that Baby Blues got its budget slashed. Now, did they see this as a bad sign and decide to give up? Nope, they couldn't because of contracts, but did they at least reduce the episode count? Nope. Instead, they decided to outsource some of their animation to Rough Draft Studios. And it's because of this and a lot of other production mix-ups and trying to change up the formula to make the show more hip and with it, it ended up taking 5 years to make. No joke, no exaggeration, the time from the original pitch to the first airing of the first episode was 5 years. I guess it just had to be that cool that it had to wait all those years. Right. To really show you how out of touch with the viewers that the network was, they actually wanted the show's name to be changed from Baby Blues to Bluesville, further distancing itself from the original strip. But that's to be expected at this point, am I right? Which is kind of confusing for a number of reasons, because one, apparently they thought that teenage women wouldn't want to watch a show with baby in the title. Two, they didn't even bother to tell the creators about it, and then the creators had to call the network directly to get the name switched. Citing my third reason for calling this stupid, the reason you adapted Baby Blues, the sole reason, I might add, to basically clickbait your viewers into watching the show because it was attached to something popular. By removing the name Baby Blues, they would also remove the last connection that they had to the strip. Thankfully, they didn't end up going through with this and decided to air the show as Baby Blues, and it aired in a mid-season run. And that's a very, very bad sign. If you don't know what a mid-season run is, then let me explain. Say you have this show called The Steve Bob Show, and it's supposed to be a really big hit, but uh-oh, it gets canceled because everyone hates it. So it ends up getting canceled and the rest of the episodes don't get aired. But what's gonna go in its time slot? You need to pick up something. That's where the mid-season pickup comes into play. It's something to fill up the schedule, and that's about it. They usually don't last very long, and they're usually not very good. Baby Blues was one of those, and the network decided to air 2 episodes each night. Whether that was to generate more viewership, to fill up space, or to get rid of the episodes as fast as possible, I can't really say. But what I can say is that it did very, very poorly. The viewership was low, people hated it, and the fans of the strip were enraged. Who would have guessed? A bunch of people coming to watch a family-friendly comic strip adaptation end up seeing something like Family Guy? And they're mad?
What a twist!
Yeah, what a twist.
And it goes without saying that the creators of the strip weren't happy either. So, after all this, after 5 years of production, after all this work into making these original characters, after outsourcing half the episodes to another studio, the show was canceled without airing all their episodes, and keep in mind, they only had 13. So the show was that much of a failure that they couldn't stick it out for 13 episodes, and even then, they were airing 2 a night. So technically speaking, they couldn't even stick it out for 6 to 7 weeks. In fact, the Christmas episode, which was supposed to be the pilot, never even aired on the WB at all. The rest of the episodes aired for the first time on Adult Swim years later. That's where it ended up finding a small audience of people that thought it was decent. No one was really super big on the show, and it ended up fading away from Adult Swim after a few years. And that was the end. Yeah, the writing was snappy and fun sometimes. Yeah, the theme song was the Bare Naked Ladies hit It's All Been Done Before. But this wasn't Baby Blues. And if you don't mind me saying, the network was crazy to ever think a stunt like this would work. This has been said time and time again, even by myself. If you wanted to make a raunchy, adult animated sitcom that didn't push the boundaries too far but still was adult enough to get the PG rating, why did you sandwich it in with Baby Blues in the first place? Especially when you consider that out of context, the writing could be pretty good. They had the talent, they had the means to make something work. They just took this strip and slapped it on and then made it awful. It's also worth noting that the WB was so overconfident that the show was going to be a hit that they ordered a second season. In fact, by the time that Baby Blues season 1 got pulled from the network, the episodes were almost done. I'd talk more about this here, but I already did in another video called What Happened to Baby Blues Season 2, which since that video, I found out that everything I said in that video turned out to be right. So yeah, go check that one out for the full story. But as it stands, what can you, the aspiring creator, do to prevent your creation from getting destroyed like Baby Blues? All you can really do is fight for some creative control. I don't know what happened in the original pitch meeting, but I can tell you that Kirkman and Scott did not walk away with creative control. Otherwise, this big old mess would not have happened. Also, it's worth noting that the creators of the Baby Blues show, not the strip, they also got jerked around by the network. Remember, they got their budget slashed. They had to outsource some of their episodes to Rough Draft Studios. They got aired as a mid-season pickup, 2 episodes a day, and then not even being able to finish their full season. Sadly, if you're in that position, there's nothing you can really do to defend yourself. By that time, you're at the mercy of the network's airing schedule, and if it doesn't work in your favor, then, oh well. You're the only one that's gonna stand to get hurt, and more often than not, the network doesn't care. So no matter which way you slice it, Baby Blues was a disaster through and through. This just goes to show you that clickbait shows, whether they be current or past, never work out well. This is one of those television tales that's been told time and time again. Guess what? It's our turn now. Welcome to the story of one of the most disappointing and, depending on who you ask, horrifying TV finales that ever was. It's the finale to the classic NBC 80s sitcom, ALF. ALF has garnered a lot of recent controversy, though to be fair, what from the 1980s and back hasn't these days? And this is in large part because of the creator and the main star, Paul Fusco. To put it simply, Paul Fusco was a little bit weird. That's the understatement of the millennium. And even though he was difficult to work with and probably just a wee bit insane, his show got screwed over by the network in a way that very few other shows have. So get ready as we take a look at Versus the Network number 204, what happens when the network goes back on their word. Yeah, that's not a good sign, is it? Throughout its four-season run, ALF was a big hit. It had good ratings, a loyal fanbase, and a lot of merchandise like ALF dolls and Pogs.
Remember ALF? He's back! In Pog form!
Behind the scenes, the show was a wreck. That goes without saying. There's been a lot of other videos that have detailed what's gone on, so we're not gonna do it here. But what we are gonna talk about is what happened at the end. As time would go on, the show would start running out of ideas. Because of the nature of the show, ALF could never leave the house. He couldn't really meet any new people, he couldn't go on wild adventures, it was all just about ALF being snarky. With all that now being discussed, it was clear that ALF's time on the air was pretty much over. Fusco and the writing staff were running out of ideas, sure, but they still weren't entirely sure that they wanted the show to end. NBC still had the final say. And they hadn't really decided whether or not ALF was going to be renewed or cancelled. Still, though, they couldn't rely purely on that, so they decided to write up one big series finale. The episode was called Consider Me Gone, and it would tie up all the loose ends of the show. Or so they thought. The episode has ALF being, who else, but ALF, and then he gets a message from some of his friends that they found a brand new planet to colonize. So now ALF's gonna leave the Tanners, but uh-oh, he misses the ship. Well, that's not good. I guess they can come back for him, right? Nope, because the alien task force has finally caught ALF. And that's it. That's how it ends. He tries to make light of the situation, but ALF knows that this is probably the end. And wouldn't you know it, it was. So canonically, the show ends with ALF getting carried away to the government and getting dissected. Yeah, that's fun. Great. Fans were not happy with this at all. In fact, one of my personal reviewing inspirations, Rowdy C from TV Trash, has personally said that this is his least favorite series finale of all time. And it's because of this finale that he still holds a grudge against NBC to this very day. What's worse is that a lot of the younger fans weren't really sure how to process this because they didn't know this was the finale. They tuned in next week to see some kind of big resolution where ALF either, I don't know, breaks out of the prison or makes friends with some of the FBI agents. But no, that didn't happen. There was no new episode, so to them, ALF was dead. But oh, they're just being silly little kids, right? They gotta learn how to process mature themes. This is how the show wanted to end it, so they gotta grow up. Except, no, that's not true at all. They had every reason to believe that there was gonna be a part two. Same with the older fans. People like Rowdy C came back the next week and found that it wasn't the new episode that they were promised. Meaning either one of two things. One, they missed it, or two, there never was a part two at all. And yeah, like I said, this was how the show ended, so there was no part two. Except you wouldn't know that if you watched the original broadcast, because it had at the very bottom of the screen at the end, to be continued. See, this isn't a trick of the eyes, this isn't some kind of editing thing. This is how it was when it originally aired. Consider Me Gone was supposed to be a part one of a two-part finale. NBC explicitly promised the crew of ALF that no matter what happened, whether or not the show would be renewed for a fifth season, they would get one last episode to resolve the cliffhanger, except Uh-oh, they decided that they didn't want to do that anymore. Once Consider Me Gone aired, they decided that ALF was done and finished. But what are they going to do about that to be continued at the end of Consider Me Gone? Obviously, they had to resolve it somehow, and guess what? They did, by removing the to be continued blurb from all future reruns. That's not really what the fans wanted, but it's what they got, so I guess NBC knows what's best, right? Years later, and I do mean years later, there was a revival movie meant to finish the cliffhanger that Consider Me Gone left the audience with called Project ALF, and it sucks. Yeah, the story concludes, but most of the main cast doesn't return, ALF is a secondary character in his own movie, and the overall writing style is basic and flat. Plus, it aired on ABC, not NBC, so a lot of people don't really consider this canon. Personally, though, whether it's between Project ALF or Consider Me Gone, I consider Project ALF canon because I do not like that ending in Consider Me Gone. But considering that this movie was on ABC and not NBC, it shows that no matter how much time has passed, even after all the angry letters and protests, NBC would not go back on their decision. Nope, they were right. ALF should have ended like this. So a lot of you who've been watching the channel will probably go, your criticism doesn't make any sense. Didn't you praise the Dinosaurs finale changing nature for being dark and provocative? Absolutely, and I still will to this very day. But ALF's finale is no changing nature. Changing nature was dark on purpose. It had a dark ending that, yes, was somewhat scientifically accurate. I mean, I don't think they launched missiles into the sky to cause the ice age, but the dinosaurs are most certainly extinct. We all kinda knew this was coming. But it was also a story that set up a dark and thought-provoking tale. One that still managed to be funny on its own right, but also be a satisfying, albeit depressing, end to a beloved show. Consider Me Gone, yes, has a bad ending, but it really just feels like a part one. Clearly, there's a bunch of setup for a part two that was supposed to happen. On its own, it feels incomplete. And if you consider this the canon end to ALF, then this just feels wrong. The Tanners don't get a happy ending, ALF doesn't get a happy ending. And again, going back to dinosaurs, yeah, they don't get a happy ending, but one, again, dinosaurs are gone, so what do you expect? But two, a lot of the dinosaurs brought this fate on themselves. It was because of BP Richfield and the people at the We Say So Corporation that Pangaea got destroyed, and then Earl, of course, put in the final blow. It was a group effort to destroy the world, albeit not intentionally, but you still can't help but feel that they got the ending they deserved. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that the Sinclairs, Monica, or Roy were bad people. I'm just saying that the punishment fits the crime. What has ALF done in-universe? I mean, on the set he was a nightmare, but in-universe? He tried to eat cats. He was snarky. Yep. Execute him. He is not fit for this world. Why did NBC do this? Just to be jerks, pretty much. We never really got a solid reason, so all we can really assume is that it was out of spite. Is that a good reason to do this, though? No! Don't punish the fans for something that the crew did. And even then, it wasn't the crew, it was just one guy. If Fusco was this difficult to work with, if the episodes of ALF took this long to make, shouldn't you do something about Fusco and not do something to the audience? This is a little bit of a lesson for both sides. For the network, treat your shows well, because if you do, then your audience will be happy and you'll start getting all that sweet, sweet money. It's also good to keep your promises, because if you don't, you're gonna get a reputation. People won't want to work with you because they won't trust you. And if they don't trust you, then you're gonna be out of business in no time. Of course, NBC wasn't out of business, but still, I'm just saying. If this keeps happening over and over again, you're gonna hurt. But also still, what can you as a creator learn from this? Well, there's two aspects to this lesson. One, don't be a mess on set. Whether you're an animated show, live action show, whatever. If you're this much of a hassle, if you take this long to make your episodes, the network's gonna wanna cut ties with you. And I don't know if this is really the reason why they canceled ALF and left it on a cliffhanger. I can't really be sure. But I'm sure it had some contributing factor. Even so, I still don't think that justifies them. I mean, come on, you couldn't have stuck it out for one more episode? But the second thing to learn is that you've always got to be prepared. Use that old Boy Scouts motto, you know? The network could one day decide, nah, we don't like you anymore. Time to kick you to the curb, and you gotta be ready. Otherwise, you're not just gonna suffer, but the fans will as well. They're either gonna get no ending at all, an ending that rubs them the wrong way, or a made-for-TV movie that comes 6 years after the show gets canceled and everyone hates. Some creators write their finale scripts way ahead of time just in case something like this happens. Honestly, this is probably a good practice. Yeah, show business is business. It's all about the money at the end of the day. But still, for those passionate creators out there that want to make people laugh or tell a story, it can be about the fans just as much, if not more, than it is about money. So please, for all you future creators out there, be prepared. If the network decides to go back on their word and basically lie to you, you've got to be ready. Don't trust them as far as you can throw them. Otherwise, you'll end up just like Alf. Before this video starts, I want to give a shout out to Louisville Nick. Congratulations, Nick. You were the only person who was able to correctly guess every single Versus the Network video through those vague hints on that one community post. And as promised, here's your shout out. Congratulations, you earned it. And now, on to the video. Here on Versus the Network, we've covered a lot of different types of shows. Shows that were the network's golden boy, only to get stabbed in the back. Shows that were never the golden boy, and in fact were explicitly targeted. And even ones that straddled a line between positive and negative interactions with the network, just kinda walking on a tightrope the entire time, and trust me, that's not any better than the other two. But now, we're gonna take a look at a Versus the Network first. I'll tell you why in just a minute, but first let me introduce you to the subject of today's video, the great comedy series that really needs a lot more attention, My Name is Earl. This is made by the same people that made Raising Hope. Oh, you've never seen that either? You guys need to watch more shows, or maybe I need to watch less, I don't know. Anyways, My Name is Earl is a dark, offbeat comedy about this guy named Earl who used to be a low-life, petty thug. But now, he's stopped his life of crime and wants to make the world a better place. Sort of. What he wants to do is make up for his mistakes. He has this list of people that he's wronged somehow all throughout his life, and he wants to fix it all. That way, he can get good karma and therefore a good life. And also to stop being a terrible person, that's a big part of it, so him, alongside his dim-witted brother Randy, go all around their town trying to find all the people they wronged, and hijinks ensue. This is a dark show with a twisted sense of humor, but it's also got this sense of groundedness to it, and for some reason, Earl is kind of a lovable character because even though he's not the smartest or best guy around, he means well and he really does want to do what's right. I'm only telling you this to reemphasize the fact that the show works. It's very, very good. And if you haven't seen it, please go check it out. It's definitely worth your time. But there is one thing you're gonna have to know about the ending, which we'll get into later. Maybe we'll have a full My Name is Earl video someday here on Media Mementos, but for now, we're going to get into Versus the Network number 206. What happens when the network is actually innocent? Yeah, Versus the Network doesn't always have to be about the network being the bad guy. Sometimes it's the show's fault. And the reason I decided to do this with My Name is Earl is because a lot of people feel that this show was screwed by the network. That's actually not true. Almost everything that happened to the show is its own fault. There is one aspect that I have to agree with the show on over the network, but once again, we'll get to that towards the end. My Name is Earl was ran on NBC, and it was a big hit. Season 1 got a lot of viewership and great critical response. Once again, it was dark but also lovable, offbeat but also coherent. It was an adult show that was more than just haha violence or haha sex, although it is worth noting that this show had a fair bit of both. Every episode in the first season was about Earl finding something on his list, going up to that person, trying to change it, and then getting involved in some crazy situation that's larger than life but also really hilarious. People cared about Earl, Randy, his ex, her new husband, everybody. So the show was a decent-sized hit. It wasn't as big as something like, say, Friends or Will and Grace, but I don't think it's supposed to be. It's just kind of, well, My Name is Earl. Season 2, however, is where things got a little different. And I guess different's an understatement because this is where everyone considers the show to kind of go off the rails. It really didn't take long, did it? So what's the premise of My Name is Earl? It's about Earl trying to go through his list and make things right to the people he wronged. Well, season 2 does that, but there's no list. He'll be good to people and he'll help them, but he won't do anything on his list. From there, a lot of people raise their eyebrows going, wait, wasn't the whole point of this show to get Earl to cross every item off of his list? What's he taking all these detours for? This is delaying the inevitable. It's kind of like if in Pokemon, Ash decided to stop catching all the Pokemon and only focus on a select- Oh wait, no, he actually did that. Never mind, let me find a better example, got it. It's like if in Modern Family, a lot of the episodes towards the end decided to focus on the parents instead of the kids. So basically, it trims the cast in half and only focuses on, like, Phil and Gloria and Cam and- Wait. That did that as well. Okay, you get what I'm trying to say here, right? It was going against its own premise, and people did not like that, and they also didn't like what came after. Like I mentioned, Earl is an ex-con. He was in jail for a while, and that's one of the reasons why he decided to straighten up and fly right. However, there's a part in My Name is Earl where they end up having Earl go back to jail, and then the show kind of becomes that for a while. Like, it's a story arc, I get it. But it's not really My Name is Earl anymore, it's Earl is the New Black. The writing here becomes a lot less funny. It's not bad. I will say that. It is not bad, but it's not nearly as great as what we saw before. Nor is it as interesting either, because now he's in jail, it feels like the character just regressed. And then he gets out of jail, gets into a coma, gets out of the coma, gets married, loses his wife to an Amish community. It's a lot. The fans of the show started leaving around here because of the jail stuff and also the fact that the episodes were changing in structure. Not really the stories, although, yeah, you can kind of tell there's a lot of story changes here. But also because the episodes became really serialized. I've seen a lot of older reviews online where people are saying you can't just sit down to watch the show anymore, it has to be this whole comprehensive experience. And they're right. I love the season 3 episodes, even the coma ones, I thought they were really funny. But yeah, if you just watch season 3 episode 4 on its own, you don't get the same impact as you would if you saw the others before it. And then of course the ones after. It's like what happened with South Park in the 2010s. They decided to forego the episodic stuff in favor of more story-focused serialized sagas, and it didn't really work. So where does Versus the Network come in through all this? Well, NBC was still good to the show. It was letting them try new things, it was letting them get darker. They were giving them no issues at all, despite the fans leaving in droves. And this was going on for 2 seasons, don't forget. Seasons 2 and 3 had mass exoduses of fans that were never coming back. Ratings were dropping, reviews were getting worse, but NBC stuck by the show. However, enough was enough eventually, and season 4 was a little bit of a return to form. It still wasn't quite the same as season 1. Still good. Again, I have to say that, still good. But by this point, it was already too late. They could hit the reset button all they wanted, and it wouldn't make a difference because the damage had been done. Going back to Modern Family, it's like when that show started getting a bit better in season 10. There's no way that the thousands of fans that jumped ship in season 6 and 7 were ever gonna come back to see it. And thus, season 4 of My Name is Earl was the end. And this is where we get to the one part I can balk at NBC for, is the fact that they canceled My Name is Earl on a cliffhanger, so it's kind of like ALF, only unlike ALF, Earl doesn't have a TV movie to finish the story. There were a lot of attempts at revivals, but it would always involve lower budgets and lower pay for everyone involved, and they just didn't see it as worth it, so the show ended up ending. That was it. I guess it's possible that the show could be revived even today, but don't hold your breath, it's very unlikely. Since then, the show's fanbase has gotten really mad at the network for canceling it on a cliffhanger, for not letting it go on even longer, and for quote-unquote stifling it, but no, that's not true. Like I said, they had a lot of creative freedom with the show, it wouldn't have been nearly this dark if the network didn't care. They most certainly did. They stuck by Earl for as long as they could. But eventually, there just weren't enough people watching and it wasn't bringing in any money, so they had to throw it aside. It's kinda like Invader Zim, one of the very, very, very few cancellations that Nickelodeon has done that's somewhat justifiable. See, the real reason Invader Zim was canceled, aside from not being as popular as SpongeBob, I hate that reason, was because around that time the show was costing more money than it was making, and Earl was the same. See, as much as people don't really like to think about it, show business really is a business. Networks have to think about the almighty dollar in order to stay alive. If a show isn't viable, it has to leave. And I know a lot of you out there are saying, well, channels like NBC or ABC or Okay, not UPN, but all these others, they're mega corporations. They can afford to lose a couple thousand dollars here and there. Well, yeah, but they're not gonna do it. Again, it's a business, and if you have a part of your business that's making you lose money, you wouldn't want to keep that around, would you? But for all those out there who want to make a show themselves, or who want to work on a big-time TV or streaming service production, make sure that the network cares about you like they did with Earl. If they give you creative control, give you freedom of speech, and make sure that you're promoted very well, then you're gonna be okay. One of the reasons I wanted to make this video was to show you that the network isn't always in the wrong. We've told you about a lot of TV versus the network horror stories, like The Weird Al Show, or Family Guy, or Dilbert, or VeggieTales, or Pinky and the Brain. It's just, there's so many, and all of them have been negative, and I really, really don't want to scare our potential creatives out there. I'm willing to guess that about 10% of our audience here wants to make a show or game or something of their own, and I don't want you to go into it thinking that the network is always out to get you, or you have to look out for evil and treachery every step of the way. I gotta tell you, these stories may be well publicized, but they're not the end-all be-all experience out there. And also, I want to let you know that sometimes it really is the show's fault. Even if the show is great, they could just get off the beaten path and try something too different that's not in tune with the original show. They could have good humor and good writing and all that, but if they don't stick to the original premise, and if they go against what made them popular, that's their fault. Not the network's. So yes, for the very first time in Versus the network wins. And as one last little piece here for our final episode of Versus the Network 2, I want to tell you how the show was supposed to end, according to the creator. So, Earl was never going to finish his list. It was going to go uncompleted throughout the entire show. This is because, not only are there a lot of things on that list, but also, Earl eventually bumps into someone with a list of their own, and Earl is on it. So, they apologize to Earl and want to make things right. Earl then learns that a lot of people in the town have done the same thing. They have lists of their own, they're trying to do right. So with Earl accidentally causing this giant chain reaction of do-gooding, if that's even a word, he feels like he's finally made amends enough and then gets rid of the list. He can go on living a prosperous, sort of, carefree life, just like he always wanted.